A
हेलो,
वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू वन एंड ऑल। आई एम निधि बघेल एंड आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू दिस सेशन ऑफ ऑरेंज सिटी लिटरेचर फेस्ट 2020। टुडे आवर सेशन इज ऑन फैक्टर्स कॉजिंग द ग्रोथ ऑफ टेररिज्म विद कर्नल सिंह इन कॉन्वर्सेशन विद भुवन गुप्ता। आवर स्पीकर फॉर द सेशन कर्नल सिंह इज अ 1984 बैच आईपीएस ऑफिसर and an engineer from the Delhi College of Engineering and the Indian Institute of Technology, Kanpur. He has over 34 years of experience in the investigation of corruption, terrorism, money laundering, and criminal cases. In the Delhi Police Special Cell, he spearheaded the investigation of the 2008 Delhi Blast cases, which led to the Butler House encounter. He is a recipient of the President's Police Medal for Distinguished Service and Police Medal for Meritorious Service. Our moderator for the session, Bhuvan Gupta, is a journalist with the Times of India. He is a management professional who gave in to his ever-enduring desire to pursue journalism. Bhuvan now writes and edits news stories for Times of India's Nagpur edition. I am sure we are going to have a great session. I will notify with the help of a bell sound and last 10 minutes will be left so that we can conclude the session without any hassles. I now hand over to the moderator. Bhuvan sir, over to you.
Thank you, Nidhi. Thanks a lot. And welcome to all the viewers who are joining us for this session and for the Orange City Literature Festival in general. This conversation is especially relevant because it addresses something that is almost universally condemned but scarcely understood, that is terrorism. And it takes someone with years of experience on the ground, with their eyes and ears on the ground, someone like Mr. Kernal Singh, to make sense of it for us. And as Nidhi mentioned, in addition to his 34 years of experience as an IPS, and in addition to him spearheading the Delhi Police Special Cell for the investigation of the Butler House case, as well as the blasts, he has also recently come out with the book on the encounter. And that book specifically addresses the various tenets and the nuances related to the entire event. Thank you so much, Kernal Singh sir, for joining us.
Thank you.
I would like to start by, you know, going back to the very roots of terrorism. To understand the factors causing the growth of terrorism, we need to first understand where it stems from and what are its various origins. Of course, terrorism is not just originating from one source or in one way. So perhaps if you could touch upon the genesis of terrorism.
See, there are different types of terrorism. One is ethno-nationalist terrorism. For example, we have certain tribes in northeastern area of our country. Naga tribes, even the Mizo tribes. The Mizoram also terrorism is started because they feel that there should be separate Mizo state. Similarly, Naga started their agitation that they wanted a separate Naga state, which comprising of various areas of India as well as outside India. But with the passage of time, Mizoram has become the state free of the terrorism. Nagaland also, there is now peace and they are not asking for separatism. They want to live within the country. Then there are religious terrorism, which we generally come say jihadi terrorism. They consider violence as a divine duty. We can see it is in the Afghanistan area, Kashmir, formation of ISIS, Indian Mujahideen, and various other groups operating in various parts of the world and even in India. Third is a political ideology. We have seen left-wing Naxalism, which is based on Marx philosophy, and ultimately the Maoist theory. Then we have right wing, which wants to like go back to the past, like Nazism and Fascism in Italy. Nazism was in Germany. Then we have state sponsored terrorism. One country tries to create terrorist activities in the other country. In India, we have terrorism, which is originating from Pakistan. There are various terrorist organizations which are based there. the terror financing, terror training camps are there. The terrorists, after they are to be caught, they take shelter, weapons are provided to them. Then there could be socio-economic causes. Like in Assam, it is started with infiltration of Bangladeshi in Assam. Then there's the borderland area, which is basically, again, we can say it is based on ethnicity. There could be historical reason. Northeastern insurgency comes from historical reason as well as from ethnicity. Kashmir is a purely historical. If we consider these things, for example, if we take Kashmir, it is state-sponsored because the terrorists started infiltrating in Kashmir since 1980s. What happened is there was a terrorism which flourished in Afghanistan. And thereafter, these terrorists started coming to Kashmir based on the philosophy of that if there is perceived or real atrocities on any Muslims anywhere in the world, then it is a duty of every Muslim to take action in that part of the world. Then Kashmir is also historical because it starts from 1947 when our country became independent and Pakistan attacked to take part of it. Of course, it has taken some part of it, which is now known as Pak-occupied Kashmir. If we go to the another type of insurgency in India, that is based on Naxalism. To begin with, it is started with the requirement of land reforms. The farmers wanted, who are tillers of the land, wanted land to come to them. The land reforms were done in the 50s. Jamidari Abolition Act was passed, but unfortunately in some of the states, it could not be implemented properly. And it also resulted into non-development issues in the remote areas. With the passage of time, of course, the now government wants to develop those areas. But the terrorists or insurgent in those areas now do not want that development to take place, because they are collecting huge funds through extortion. Then there is a jihadi terrorism which is taking place in various parts of the country. For example, there have been a blast in Mumbai, 26/11 in Mumbai, blasts in Delhi and various parts of the country. Again, these jihadi terrorism is sponsored by our neighboring country. If you go to the northeast, I have already told it is based on ethnicity, as well as when India became independent, there was not total control of the government at that time on these areas. And because of that, they felt that they should be an independent country. And insurgency started in that area because of that. That is a basic reason of terrorism in various parts of our country.
Right. So if you talk about what takes people, these causes, what takes people over the tipping point? What causes people who are afflicted by these causes or who come across such ideologies to actually take that plunge and get into something as vicious as terrorism? What are the contributing factors, you think, to take the people over this tipping point?
See, the one is, and most important is, perceived or real feeling of persecution. And it leads to radicalization. I'll give an example which I have given in my book on Bartla House encounter. The Indian Mujahideen terrorists, how they would radicalize others. They would start telling their co-students that how to perform religious rites. Nothing wrong in that. Slowly they will start a perception that they're better in religious knowledge than others. Then they would start telling them about what is jihad, why it should be done, what is the purpose of it. And thirdly, after convincing them that jihad is important, then they would come to the idea of that the Muslims are being persecuted in different parts of the world. They have clippings of various countries with them. With this passage, the person will be started believing that it is his duty to do it, and then starts joining their stream. So it is a process of radicalization, which is very, very important. And today the social media is playing a very important role in the sense that everything is available on social media, on internet. The radicalization can be done through the process of chat rooms, through the process of reading what is going on internet. The person may get affected with the ideology, may influenced by the ideology, and adopt that ideology without even associating with that particular organization.
Right.
We have seen the people getting influenced by the ideology of Osama bin Laden, though he is not there, but the people, Al-Qaeda, they get into that. There is also funding which can help them in continuing the process of terrorism.
Right. So I want to pick up from just what you briefly touched upon is the funding, the logistics that enable such large scale and such elaborately planned terrorist activities. Is there a mechanism by which they are able to do this again and again and escape, sometimes escape the intelligence agencies, and even policing may not always be able to tackle it the way they would like to? Is there a reason why they have a mechanism like that? What are the logistics that support such activities?
See, the terrorism is done by the people who are motivated. They're very, very motivated to it. And therefore, the information is very difficult to come. The manual information is almost impossible who is involved in the terrorist activities. In the case of terror financing, when we are talking, let's take example of the Naga insurgents or insurgency in the Manipur area. Their main collection is extortion. Any activity, whether development activities taking place there or whether any governmental activities going on there, because of the fear, they're able to extort money from the people. That is one. Similarly, if you take Naxalism, the same process, whatever is cultivated in that area, when that cultivation product goes out in the market, they take cut. Whosoever is developing that area, the people who are given tenders to develop that area, for example, making the roads, the cut is taken from them. The huge funds are collected, which would be used for the terrorist purposes. Then we have the state sponsored, where the neighboring country is providing funds. The ISI is providing funds. We have also criminal activities. I'll take example of Indian Mujahideen. In the beginning of their initiation, they started kidnapping of the people. And through kidnapping, they collected huge funds. And a part of their fund, they had also provided for 9/11 attack. They have collected so much funds from the extortion activities. Then we have this Golden Crescent covering of basically Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Iran area. Now, in this area, huge quantity of the opium is grown, converted into heroin, and then taken out to Western countries. The huge profit is earned by these Al-Qaeda, the various terrorist organizations. And this funds comes to Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jaish-e-Mohammed, the Haqqani network, Taliban, and it is about, if you can consider, it is about to the tune of almost 1.5% of the world GDP. So much is the output from this. And that funds is used for terrorist purposes. Then the charity funds are collected. For example, we have Jamaatul Dawa, a front organization of Lashkar-e-Taiba in Pakistan. It collects charity funds, and it is doing charity also in the sense that they have hospitals, they have schools, educational institutions are there. But a part of that goes to terrorist purposes. similarly, there's a concept in Islam. The concept is of zakat, that a part of the income should be given for charity purposes. Mm-hmm. This is collected by the organizations from the people, and then they spend. In 99, we had arrested one person known as Abu Nasir. He was from Burmese origin, but working in Pakistan in one of such organizations. Now, he told us that he was going and giving these funds to the terror camps. At that time, even FBI team came to India, to Delhi, to interrogate him, to find out where all the terrorist camps were there, are there in the Afghanistan and Pak-occupied Kashmir. So these are the various ways they collect funds. And funds are then transmitted either through Hawala or through the banking channels.
Right. So I want to touch upon, you know, the people around those that become the terrorists, the parents, the guardians, those around them who, you know, may have had the chance to stop them from becoming terrorists or in some way preventing it. What is their role? How do you think they're also in part sometimes responsible for preventing that radicalization?
See, I would not say that they are responsible for that. But I feel that they could have had better control, in the sense that where the child is going, young boys are going from the home away for 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, like taking training in Pakistan, they are out for 6 months, not in touch with their family. So family members should ask them at least that, where had you gone? What was your purpose? With that, this control of the parental and societal control, there's a possibility to identify that person is being radicalized. And there's a possibility that family itself can de-radicalize the person. Or is they can report to the state, and where state can try to de-radicalize those person. So that before they could act in real, they could be prevented in doing so. And the youth can be prevented. Their career can become better.
Right. So I want to now go on to, you know, the consequences. Once a terrorist act occurs and the police and administration are on the case, they're trying their best to investigate and put an end to it. The consequences may not always be favorable and may not always help the case, as you have mentioned in your book as well. The media trial that ensued during the Butler House encounter did not necessarily help the case. Would you like to touch upon how that can be a harmful effect?
See, what happened in the, particularly when Butler House encounter took place, it was in September 2008. There were elections in five states, assembly elections, starting from November 2008, and parliamentary election in the early of 2009. Some of the politicians started using this as an opportunity for the vote bank politics. And the media also got influenced. And what happens is, when the politicians and the senior level politicians are speaking something, even without evidence, people start believing it. People start perceiving that it is to be true. That means there was something wrong in encounter. And when they say that particular community has been hit, see, what you are doing is you are basically working against that community itself, creating a wrong feelings in the minds of the people that they are being persecuted, while that is not true. The police is only going after the terrorists. They may belong to any religion, any caste, any creed. Nobody knows the causes, because when terrorism was in Punjab, there were different people. When it is in the Northeast, different people. So one cannot blame the community on that. And when the politicians speak like that, it gives a wrong impression, and which is harmful to the nation.
Right.
Therefore, I feel that there should be a national policy and consensus on the terrorism by any political party. Because once any politician speaks, he should speak with evidence, and otherwise he should not speak against such things.
Right. I remember in your book, there's a mention specifically of a news report that came out that wrongfully painted the facts, that presented that three bullets were hit on the back of the terrorist, and also about a scuffle breaking out between the alleged terrorist and the police officers, and them dragging people back upstairs. Did all of that also come in the way of your investigation?
See, that not. Let me tell you what was the report first. See, the news item says that they found an eyewitness who saw everything happening from his bathroom window. What he saw, they said that that police people went to the flat is on the fourth floor where this incident took place. They went up, they dragged people down, killed at the ground floor. Then they brought them up and they dragged them up, and then they wrapped them in cloths, brought some more people which were arrested. Then this news item also says that Mohan Chand Sharma, the inspector who died after this during this encounter, he got 3 bullet injuries on his back, fired by his colleagues only. Now, if we see the factuality, this L18 Bartla House is a fourth floor. Neighboring adjoining buildings are only 2 floors. Nobody can see. From the second floor, you are seeing the fourth floor, what is happening on the stairs. There were no drag marks on those bodies. And if such eyewitness was existing, he never came. Not in any forum, not any other newspaper, not anywhere. He was anonymous. The postmortem report clearly indicated that Mohan Chand Sharma got bullet injury from the front and 2 bullet injury. This news item also said that these people did not fire on police. There's a test known as dermal nitrate test. What happens is when somebody fires, the particles, they deposit on his hands, the explosive particles. And the doctors in Ames, while doing the postmortem of the terrorists, they got the hand wash, sent it to the CFSL, where it came that the gunpowder was found on their hands, proving clearly that they had fired. But such stories try to create an impression which is far from truth, which is beyond even, which is not based on any evidence.
Did it also lead to any friction with the kin and family members of the deceased and those injured?
See, deceased, you mean police officer?
Yes.
See, certainly it creates, and I have mentioned in my book, I went to Mohan Chand Sharma's house with my wife. So Mohan's wife, Maya, asked me this question, that there are stories about the encounter, that it was not genuine. What do you have to say? And I mentioned that I talked to her saying, do you trust me? She told me that her husband had told that at every time, whatever happens, but you must trust the joint CP. So then I told her, this is what has happened and this is the truth. It goes to her credit that she stood firm thereafter. She was even offered a ticket for election. She did not take the ticket. It is a creditable to the family members of the police officers to take such things in stride. There is a tremendous stress on the people, on the families. But they withstood that.
Right. Taking this a bit forward and looking at it in a broader perspective, looking at your experience, how do you feel all these people, you know, who in a way become affected by the terrorist activities, not just the victims, their families, police officers' families, everyone who did not necessarily want to become a part of it. The areas where such an encounter happens, I'm sure there are years of trauma after the blasts take place. What are the kind of consequences do you see after any such act happens?
See, when there is a terrorist act takes place, number one is who are the victims? Innocent people. Somebody has gone to the market and gets killed there or gets injured. It is a trauma to that person, trauma to the family members. And it is a long-term trauma. I remember in 98, in Karol Bagh, there was explosion in a kulfi shop. One girl who was to be married a few days later got her injured and got her both the legs amputated. He came for giving evidence in the court. See, one can see the trauma to these people. It is not a one time. It is the whole life these people have to suffer.
Right.
For example, this Indian Mujahideen, the people who were killed and caught after the Bhatla House encounter, they have caused explosion starting from 2005 to 2008 at various places. Varanasi, Hyderabad, UP courts, Jaipur, Gujarat, Delhi, killing 239 people and injuring 851. It's a huge loss. Similarly, if we see the security agencies, every year around 400 to 500 security officers, that is police officers and paramilitary officers and army officers, are killed because of terrorist activities in India. It is a huge loss to their families.
Absolutely.
Do you feel on the legal front, the laws we have in our country, any changes are needed to strengthen the laws and perhaps find ways to quell terrorism on the basis of that?
See, legal front is, if you see the history of legal front in handling terrorism, before 1985, it was only the IPC, Section 121A, waging war against the state, and some of the acts like Explosive Substance Act and Arms Act. They are good for handling the criminal activities. But when it comes to terrorism, who are the dedicated people who will operate from one place after another place and run away out of the country even, these laws were inadequate. So first the Tada came in 1985 after Mrs. Gandhi was assassinated in October 1984. But in its implementations, there were certain allegations against the officers that it was not implemented properly. And then what happened is it was allowed to lapse in 1995. Then happened this parliament attack. Immediately the POTA was brought. Though POTA was also allowed to lapse in 2004 then. Thereafter, certain amendments were made in Prevention of Unlawful Activities Act. Then came this Bhatla House encounter, the explosions all over, and 2611. Right. IA was formed. Their amendments were made in Prevention of Unlawful Activities Act to handle the terror financing, to handle the members of the terrorist organizations and the terrorist acts. So if you see, these laws are changing, but there are still problems. For example, if you take the Prevention of Unlawful Activities Act, and if a police officer is investigating that, not of NIA, local police, the remand can be taken only for the first 15 days of the person. Now, it is possible that one terrorist is caught today and another terrorist is caught after 45 days or 50 days. You cannot cross-question them because you cannot take first terrorist on remand again. You have to go to the jail premises to interrogate him. In NIA Act, it has been included that piecemeal, that means they will count 30 days, but 30 days could be any time. It is not first 30 days, but it is not in the CRPC. CRPC Section 167 has only first 15 days. Then there is no undercover operations allowed. Suppose I infiltrate my officer in a terrorist organization to find out the whole network. And suppose that officer is caught by some other agency. Now it is a goodwill between my agency and their agency to leave that officer. They may not leave him. They say he is involved in terrorist activities. While various countries who are handling the terrorism, for example, United States, they have these undercover operations legalized. So there are various issues. Our laws are improving, but they're not adequate still. For example, the trial. Indian Mujahideen terrorists are being tried in the various parts of the country. And when somebody is to be tried, then he has to be brought to that particular court. Till now, from 2008 to 2020, only two cases have been finalized, one of Hyderabad, one of Jaipur. After 12 years, still the trial is going on. If you can make only one court, this terrorist organization, whosoever is investigated, but it will be tried only in one court, then the trial could take place faster.
Right. The role of the police cannot be overstated. It is, of course, one of the most thankless jobs in the world. And the police continues to go ahead and do it from the front while people, you know, theorize and think about ways to quell terrorism. Do you still feel there are some ways reform can be brought about in the way policing is done as regards to terrorism?
See, at the moment, what the policing is doing, policing is being done is when the terrorist strike takes place, the police does the investigation, or the intelligence agencies tries to find out the information. We have to act before a person becomes terrorist. That means there has to be mechanism to find out how radicalization is taking place. Can that radicalization be prevented at that stage? What is the mechanism? For example, there was a person known as Abdul Karim Tunda. He radicalized many people in madrasas. What he would do is he will go and speak there, give a taqreer, they say it is a lecture, and then he would spot some people who could be radicalized. Then he will call those people in separate room, talk to them. With the passage of time, he would be able to radicalize. We have to find a similar mechanism so that people are not radicalized. The definition of the explanation of the various the religion that should be made known to the people, what is the right explanation. There are various types of people in every religion. The progressive people are there, retrogressive people are there. So we have to catch hold of progressive people.
What kind of government response do you feel can contribute to this? The government, of course, has a different governments have tackled terrorism differently, but by and large, there are some frameworks that each government tries to follow while tackling terrorism. What do you feel is being done and what can be changed, if at all anything can?
See, at the moment, the government is doing three things, basically. One is the development aspects. See, there are places where the terrorism is or insurgency has come up because the developmental issues. So the government has a soft approach to the people, trying to give them facilities, trying to develop those areas so that the feeling that their areas have not been developed is extinguished. The second response is even after that, the people, like, for example, in certain areas, particularly Naxalites, are not allowing the development to take place. In that case, you require the security related response. That means the police acting against them. Mm-hmm. The third response of government is that to negotiate with such people, and government is doing it. The Mizoram Accord was there, where the peace was brought to the Mizoram. The Naga Accord is being done. Bodo Accord has been done recently. The government is trying to talk to the people so that the negotiation can takes place, the issues can be resolved. This is the third approach. The fourth approach is also important. That is what I was talking of, how to prevent people getting radicalized and how to de-radicalize the people who have been radicalized previously. So this approach government is taking in Kashmir now. Let's see how successful we would be able to. But the same approach is required at all the other places, like in the Naxal areas also we require such a scheme, such things, so that things can be improved.
Okay. One more thing we have to look at here is that specific which you mentioned of cutting it in the bud, stemming in the bud, and stopping people from getting radicalized. As you said, the government is doing what it can on this. But do you think, as a society, as a people, there is a bit more responsibility on us and on looking out for those around us, finding ways to stop that from happening?
Yes, I feel that as a society, we should contribute in the process for spotting people, timely trying to de-radicalize them, trying to make people understand what is right, what is wrong. And that will help in bringing down the radicalization.
Right. We have a question from the audience that we'd like to take up here. The audience question is that we know that religion is one of the factors that causes the growth of terrorism. But is it a direct factor or an indirect factor?
See, it is both direct and indirect factor. See, one is a wrong interpretation of the religion. Every religion wants peace. Every religion wants everybody to be equal, because every religion feels God is one. But there is a misinterpretation, and this misinterpretation is taught to the people, and they start feeling that what they are doing is the right. See, even if there is something misinterpretation, the people cannot use it unless there are certain causes. They may be real causes, they may be perceived causes. For example, when things were happening in Afghanistan, the people from various parts of the world were going to the Afghanistan, feeling that there is a persecution of the people, of their community. That causes, the perceived causes have to be removed, or real causes have to be removed.
Right. Looking forward, how do you see our as a world, not just as India, the fight against terrorism going? Do you feel there are strong inroads being made? What do you think can be the way forward, or how do you see it going?
See, after 9/11, there has been a sea change. The United Nations thereafter started targeting the terrorists, which we call United States in UN Security Council resolution, and 1270 and 1370. These are the two resolutions. By the process, they say this organization is a terrorist organization, and therefore all the fundings anywhere in the world of these terrorist organization or individual terrorists should be frozen. That's the one step the United Nations is taking. Then there is another organization which is known as Financial Action Task Force, which deals with the policies relating to money laundering and terror financing. They also monitor the legal system in various countries relating to terror financing, and also monitor whether those have been effectively implemented or not. Like Pakistan was not implementing the terror financing acts properly. Therefore, Pakistan was brought into the grey list 3-4 years ago. If some country is brought into the grey list of Financial Action Task Force, then the economic help from other countries starts getting down on that country. And if it is brought to the black list, then there will be economic problem to that particular country. So the world over, there is a legal system coming over, monitored by the United Nations and the Financial Action Task Force. And international cooperation in terror-related cases is very forthcoming.
Right. Finally, sir, as you know, social media has evolved into gigantic proportions now over the years, and it has assumed a face which, you know, not many of us would have thought it would. How do you see that what kind of role, both in a positive and negative way, playing in terms of terrorism, both in growing and trying to prevent?
See, social media can become a tool for negative and positive both. One sees irresponsibility on social media nowadays. We see Twitter, we see other places, people speak anything. it also gives a space to people to coordinate with each other, to talk to each other, to radicalize people also. It gives the space. So social media is becoming a tool in the hands of terrorist organizations. The enforcement agency also should use it.
Right.
As a tool to de-radicalize people, to propagate policies or philosophies to counter what terrorists are doing.
Right. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot for your all-encompassing views, which were so thought-provoking for us, especially since so many of us have no idea of what exactly is going on the ground and are entirely going by reports or, as we discussed, social media. Thanks a lot for your time. Thank you, viewers, for joining us. Thank you. Back to you. Over to you, Nidhi.
That's the problem.
Thank you, Colonel sir and Bhuvan sir, for such an amazing session on such a sensitive topic which always needs attention. On behalf of the Orange City Literature Fest, we sincerely express our gratitude towards your acceptance for the session and knowledge shared with us. Thank you all for watching and being a lovely audience. Special thanks to SGR Knowledge Foundation. The next session on the perils and politics of history writing in India is scheduled from 5 p.m. Have a nice day.
Thank you.
Twenty years of existence. Two universities. 23 educational institutes. Offering 137 courses. Rice Oni Group of Institutions, a vision beyond.